In the summer of 1963, the last thing the people of America expected was to be utterly swept away by a live recording of a 12-year-old blind boy from Detroit leading a big, energetic band with his voice and harmonica. But that is what we got, as this record shot to number one on Billboard's Hot 100. That, of course, was none other than Little Stevie Wonder, whose long and rich musical career these five decades has given us so much in addition to this, his first major hit. In Eli Siegel's great lecture, Animate and Inanimate Are in Music and Conscience, he said, quote, "One of the beliefs of aesthetic realism is that every person, in being himself and trying to be not interested in other things, is accepting the inanimate in a bad sense. The other thing, the meeting of what is not oneself in a live fashion, that is how it can be said quickly, has much meaning too," unquote. I believe the reason this recording was so loved and is still is that it calls to and deeply stirs that desire in each of us to meet what is not oneself in a live fashion. I think people felt, without knowing it, that this brave young man of Detroit was joyously pulling for us to abandon our own dull, miserable desire to be ourselves by trying to be not interested in other things, to be inanimate in the bad sense. This recording is called Fingertips Part 2 because it is really the concluding portion of a longer instrumental jam that took place at a live Motown show. The piece itself, Fingertips, was composed by Clarence Paul and Henry Cosby. Part 2 commences at a moment where the audience has already been brought to a high level of excitement when Stevie suddenly engages them in a call and response with a command which is both sweet and penetrating. Everybody say yeah! That one syllable, yeah, takes on a life of its own as it arcs through time and space. The audience responds, and with each new round of call and response, the excitement builds till Stevie finally hits that phrase, yeah, 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 and his harmonica and the band just take off into an ecstatic flight, like a skylark in the midst of the most orderly hurricane. Is this life? Is this animation? Or what? Everybody see yeah! See yeah! The band has a mighty, towering quality. It surges back and forth between two chords, C minor and F major. Those chords have an effect. Neither one, as you can hear, is really a resting point. They keep calling to each other, urging each other on, not to settle.
For example, you could have two chords in which their relation made you feel, after the second chord, you've come to rest. Like this. Done. But if you have C minor leading to F, You can't rest. It's more like a pendulum back and forth. You can't choose between these two as a point of rest. It could go on forever.
While that's going on in the band, Stevie's harmonica seems to stand for a single self, just joyfully cutting loose, while also fitting in quite well with these waves of orchestral sound. What does this all mean? In a lecture, Eli Siegel explained, there is a desire in every person to be wild, but not sloppy. And he said, quote, music itself is composed of two things, as we all are. The very cold thing, which is technique, and then what the heart is looking after, what the blood is seeking. There is a desire for full release in every person. Aesthetic realism sees the purpose of mind as getting to be free, that is, the ability to be entirely as one wants to be. People will find release by being angry. They will find release by trying to get to a feeling of nothing at all. But the desire to be entirely free must go along with the desire to be orderly and accurate, unquote. It might be said that the words in the song are not so crucial, but then again, they are. What does it mean to say, yeah, and to call on others to say, yeah, with such tremendous exuberance? And yes, that excited audience is forever a part of this performance. I think that in this song, Stevie Wonder, with his voice and with harmonica, triumphantly, mischievously making its way through the sound of that massive, many-colored orchestra, is standing for the desire in every one of us to feel that we will be fully ourselves, not by absenting ourselves from reality, but by diving in, hoping to meet it with all of ourselves. We are being told to say yeah to life, to existence itself. Very dramatic in this recording are the opposites of vulnerability and power, quiet and crash. After the wailing first round of orchestra and harmonica rocking the rafters, the child's voice of Stevie Wonder gets softer on, just a little bit of soul, yeah. Then another passionate call for greater animation with, clap your hands just a little bit louder, clap your hands just a little bit louder, and back we go into the joyful storm. This next round of controlled ecstasy is followed by a fervent harmonica solo by Stevie Wonder, very personal, almost naked, accompanied only by the rhythmic hand claps of the audience. We feel a single, animate self, and at the same time, man, does this solo have form, structure, masterfully leading us back to yet another unfettered instrumental passage. Listen to for the wonderful drum playing of Marvin Gaye. Yes, that Marvin Gaye. Aesthetic realism for the way it is utterly and so kindly against the stultifying, deadly, inanimate in the bad sense in people, including me. It has made me far happier than I ever knew a person could be, and I'm looking to change about this more. In a class, I said I would like to understand what in me interfered with my ability to feel that I honestly like the world in an everyday, moment-to-moment way. Ellen Reese asked if I thought a person could be too conceited to like the world. I said, that's not how I put it to myself. And she humorously replied,
I'm trying to put things in a way one may not put them. We have to ask if, in that feeling, oh, things are not exciting enough, is it coming from conceit? Is there a feeling in a person who may be oneself that every time I dislike something, I'm saying I'm too good for this world that I got myself into?
I thank Miss Reese for the life, the rejuvenation, the truly animating effect that studying this discussion has had and is having on me. Towards the end of the song, in another quiet moment, Stevie sings, I know everybody here, everybody had a good time. So if you want me to, I'm going to swing the song just one more time when I come back. So goodbye. He plays a winding down figure on the harmonica, humorously throws in a phrase from a children's song that you'll recognize, then abruptly ends the whole piece, seemingly. Next, with the orchestra vamping behind, we hear the announcer's voice.
Hey, how about it? Let's hear it for him. Little Stevie Wonder, take a bow, Stevie.
Then, the part. We love this part. Don't we love this part? If you haven't met it yet, I dare you not to love it. Stevie is back, and he plays some meandering figures on the harmonica, which at first sound somewhat innocent, nonchalant, and then, without our even seeing it coming, leads us right back into that crashing ocean of sound with the orchestra, now mightier than ever. But he's not done. He's back to say goodbye. He says it 7 times. Then, I'm gonna go, yeah! I love how he screams that, yeah! But let's just swing it one more time. Something I love here, and it moves me every time I hear it, is the utter passion in how Stevie Wonder delivers that last syllable, time, and then with harmonica makes one last triumphant launch into that orchestral dynamo. This goodbye, to me, is one hell of a hello, a saying that life, beauty, meaning can never really depart.
So goodbye.
Says to me, life, life, and life again, and don't ever sell yourself anything less. I'm grateful to Aesthetic Realism for showing that that is what art has been saying all along, and for providing the solid, practical means for us to make it a reality in our lives.